thank you everyone for having me here at Blockchain University. Like Robert mentioned, I was here at the second cohort, and I learned a lot. Learned a lot about Bitcoin and Ethereum, and at the time I was working as an engineer at Ripple Labs. Ripple Labs is the creator of the Ripple network and the Ripple protocol, and I've been there for the past 2 years as a software engineer, building all kinds of different tools and solutions for different customers. And I was asked to come talk about Ripple because it is Ripple has created a blockchain, and we also have technologies around open blockchain stuff. So that's what I'm here for. And so what Ripple is, Ripple is a company now, and it's also a technology for payments between ledgers. The key fundamental goal of Ripple and what we're doing with Ripple is to connect all of the different ledgers in the world so that we can have seamless payments between networks. So right now, looking at the world, we have bank ledgers, we have PayPal ledgers, we have the Bitcoin ledger, and all of these systems, you can send money within your own ledger, within your system. If you're a Bitcoin user, you can send money to another Bitcoin user. And if you are a PayPal user, you can send money to another PayPal user. If you are in Canada and you have a bank account, you can send money to another bank in Canada because they're on the same system. But these are siloed networks, and the goal of Ripple is to connect the entire world of ledgers and of payment networks using neutral protocols for communicating value between those networks. So that's our goal at Ripple, and we've moved through several different implementations of this idea, trying to get to the most globally neutral, standardized, and scalable solution possible for connecting all the different assets in the world, all the different payment networks. Okay, so before I dive in too much, I really like to have conversation, dialogue type lecture. So if you have any questions ever at any time, just feel free to ask. Hopefully I will be able to anticipate most of those, but yeah, go ahead and raise your hand if you have any questions. Okay, so just to let you know, interledger.org is our new open source project at Ripple, and we're actually pushing this as a W3C standard. There's a W3C standard body for interledger, which is connecting different financial ledgers. And our goal with Ripple is to enable all the ledgers to be connected and to provide liquidity between all different payment systems. Okay, so here's basically how, and I'll go much more into detail, but basically how the Ripple system works is that you have someone with money on one ledger, let's say they have it on Bitcoin blockchain, and they want to get money over to someone else on a different ledger, let's say that's PayPal. In order to make that happen, there is a third person, a market maker, who has funds on both ledgers, and they facilitate a payment between those two ledgers. And the whole point of this is to make all assets liquid, no matter where they are in the world, that anyone can send money from one asset to another asset anywhere in the world. Okay, so Yes, we're aiming for a protocol, a neutral protocol that's like HTTP or SMTP. And this is fairly new stuff. We just came out with the Interledger Payments Working Group at the W3C. And so this is our goal, universal payments, an IP-based payment system that doesn't have, you don't have to use any particular ledger. I love Bitcoin, but if you want to use Bitcoin, you have to use Bitcoin. And I know there's a lot of startups, and someone was just telling me about a remittance company where you have someone has cash in one country, and they can send cash to a person in another country, and it uses Bitcoin as an intermediate ledger. That's basically what we're going for with Ripple, so that you can connect all different assets with different ledgers in between. Okay. Any questions about that so far, our high-level goal with Ripple?
Great. Who is working on the Interledger protocol?
The Interledger protocol, there's a working group, community working group. I think it has about 60 members. It's at the W3C. We have Bitcoin people, people who are into payment standards, which is like Google, Apple, Facebook, PayPal, those type of people. And then there's also traditional finance and banking people on the Interledger Working Group. And our goal is to make it as neutral as possible to create a protocol that is very much like HTTP or SMTP. The Interledger white paper here that is on this page was written by our CTO at Ripple. That's Ripple Inc. now. It used to be formerly Ripple Labs. Before that, it was OpenCoin. And okay, so you can read the white paper here if you go to interledger.org. I highly suggest reading that at your leisure in the future. Though, basically, what it details is making payments between ledgers using cryptographic escrow to enable the payments and to give you certainty that a payment is going to be moved from one ledger to another ledger by having money escrowed cryptographically. So it's a good paper. It just came out a few weeks ago, so I'm really excited about that. That's the mission of Ripple. Okay, and so we also have Ripple, the company. Ripple, the company, builds, over the last 3 years, we've built an open source software system that is running globally on a bunch of different nodes. And it allows people to create digital commodities, currency-like things, any type of digital asset. It allows you to send those assets to other users, as well as exchange them for other assets. And the purpose of this system, it is a blockchain like the Bitcoin blockchain. There's, it's a publicly available, publicly auditable database of transactions and account balances of all different types of assets. And we created this. The Ripple Ledger is what it's known as, in order to achieve our goal of connecting the different payment networks in the world. And so the technical implementation is a distributed database that's run by a bunch of nodes around the world. I'll talk more about that in detail, the Ripple D system. The Ripple, the company, also offers products for financial institutions. And these are proprietary products built on top of the open source software. So the Ripple Ledger is very analogous to Bitcoin Core, Bitcoin D. It's a global peer-to-peer system that tracks transactions, essentially. It tracks who owns what assets. And there's lots of companies who use Bitcoin Core, Bitcoin D, and they have their own proprietary software that helps different customers, achieve different, alleviate different pain points. So Ripple, the company, we build software on top of our open source system, the Ripple network, to enable banks and financial institutions to do cross-border, instant cross-border settlement, cross-currency settlement. So going along with our theme of connecting all the different stores of value in the world, all the different ledgers, we offer products for cross-currency settlement. And to facilitate that, we also offer products for market making. So in, like I described in the very beginning, in order to move money from one ledger to another ledger, there needs to be a market maker in the middle. So we help facilitate that market making. And so if you go to ripple.com these days, it's all about the corporate products that that you can buy. I wouldn't recommend buying these because you can basically get all of the, well, you probably can't buy it anyway because it's for banks, but you get all of the everything for free if you implement solutions yourself. And so everything's still on an open public blockchain. Any questions so far?
You mentioned that customers are using it to create digital assets and commodities. Can you give some examples of what the commodities and assets that we've created?
Yes. So ultimately, we basically want to move money from fiat type ledgers to other fiat type ledgers in different currencies.
It's part of the project.
Yeah. Okay. So. He's showing a settlement system that settles from different types of assets. I'll show you in a minute, but dollars, yen, yuan, euros, gold. I have my own currency called Zeiler Mark, which one Zeiler Mark is worth 1 hour of my time. So it's available on the public ledger if you want to purchase it. It's too expensive, though. You can probably buy my time for cheaper than Zeiler Mark. essentially arbitrary assets. Anyone with an account on the Ripple ledger can create any asset. It's basically a currency code that you say, if you want to create dollars, you issue USD. And if you want to create gold, you issue XAU. And it basically has no value unless you promise to redeem it for something of value. And the whole purpose of all of this is to facilitate cross-currency transactions, cross-ledger payments. So I'll show you the highest volume. Oh, wow, we've got a lot of Bitcoin volume. So this is Ripple Charts, ripplecharts.com. This is a product created by Ripple Labs, and it shows you the different assets that are trading on the network, and it should be updating in real time. You can see different capitalizations. So for instance, here if you see the red, this is all Chinese yuan. So if you have a Ripple account, you can hold these Chinese yuan, and which is actually remarkable because it's hard for a lot of people in the world to get access to Chinese yuan. But with Ripple, all you need is a Ripple account, which is a public-private key pair. So it's almost exactly the same as Bitcoin, Litecoin, Ethereum. They all use the same elliptic curve technology for establishing ownership of an account. And so we have here Chinese yuan. Anyone know what FMM is? Either that's made up or it's from the Philippines. You have Japanese yen. Here we have bitso, Mexican peso, dollars, bitcoins. And there are other things that are traded, but these are the largest markets. Okay, so so far, all I've really said about the Ripple network software is that it's analogous to Bitcoin Core. It's a peer-to-peer system that relays transactions to all the nodes in the network. The big difference between the Ripple daemon, Ripple D, and Bitcoin Core is Bitcoin supports one type of asset natively, and that's BTC, that's Bitcoin. And the Ripple ledger supports arbitrary assets, any type of thing you want to create. That's why we have all of these different assets. And then it also has its own built-in currency called XRP, which was the original intent of Ripple. Well, hopefully I'll be able to explain that in a minute. So if we're looking at this, this is charts from an exchange. So if we want to look at our trading between, say, BTC and XRP, we have order books. So another huge difference between the Bitcoin Core software and the Ripple D is Ripple D actually has an exchange built in. So in addition to storing balances, account balances, it also has order books where you can place orders to buy and sell all the different assets. And yeah.
How are you securing the currencies around the world to XRP?
Great question. So how do we secure the fiat currencies? Let me just step back real quick. When we're looking at yuan, the question was, do we accept yuan deposits? Each of these yuan is issued by a different, so this is issued by Ripple CN. It's a company in Beijing, Ripple CN, and they accept yuan into their bank account and issue yuan into the Ripple ledger. Yes, Ripple, the company, is not affiliated with Ripple CN or any of these companies. Anyone can create an asset on the ledger if they have a public-private key. And in the case of Ripple CN and Ripple Fox, this other one, they're companies in China that hold yuan reserves. They're may or may not be any legal recourse to getting your yuan, except that they have a good reputation for paying out yuan when you want it. Okay, does that answer your question?
Yeah, so the Ripple CN is Ripple's version of Coinbase in China.
Yeah, exactly. Ripple CN is like Coinbase in China. And we call them, in the Ripple parlance, the gateways. If you've ever come across that, there's probably some language in our documentation about gateways. And they are people who hold funds and issue them into the network. And it turns out that, so the reason we have people issuing assets into the ledger is in order to facilitate cross-ledger payments. These BTC, this is the order book for Bitstamp BTC and to XRP. So how this works is you actually give Bitcoins to Bitstamp, if you're familiar with that, one of the largest Bitcoin exchanges, and they issue it into the Ripple ledger. And then you can exchange them on this exchange. Okay. Any other questions so far? Excellent. So you notice that Bitstamp BTC is being traded against XRP. XRP is analogous to Bitcoin in the Bitcoin system, or it's analogous to Ether in the Ethereum system. it originally, if you look at the original blog post by the founder of OpenCoin, Jed McCaleb, he was posting on Bitcoin Talk, and he said, let's create a Bitcoin without mining. His goal was to create Bitcoin without mining with something that he called consensus, which is a different way of achieving security in the blockchain. And he came up with the idea of XRP, and it was to replace Bitcoin. Essentially, that was his dream. And so they didn't fork Bitcoin. They created a whole new system with XRP at the heart. It wasn't called Ripple then. It was basically Bitcoin without mining. And then some more people were very interested in this concept of consensus, and they took the original idea for Ripple, which was connecting ledgers, and a man named Ryan Fugger had invented this concept of Ripple, which was connecting all of the world's value and ledgers, and they decided that implementing arbitrary assets in this ledger would be the best way to achieve that ability to make payments across different ledgers. And so we had a combination of this idea of a cryptocurrency without mining, plus being able to create arbitrary assets and put it into one system. And so our goal is to have XRP serve as the most liquid asset in this system, so that anyone who has an asset that trades for XRP gets liquidity to all other assets in the world. So the idea is, the idea is that if you want to exchange between, say, Mexican peso, Chinese yuan, you can make a market by placing orders for pesos to yuan. But if you also want to market from pesos to Philippine dollars, you need to place orders from pesos to Philippine currency. And if you look at all the different combinations of currencies, this ends up being a lot of orders. Like it's either n squared or n factorial or something like that. So we realized that the easiest way to achieve liquidity would be by making markets between all the assets and XRP, so that you can easily trade, say, Japanese yuan for Bitcoin, BTC, by making a market between each of those to XRP.
So why can't Bitcoin be used to do exactly that? So instead of XRP, why can't the market be made through Bitcoin?
Oh, market definitely could be made through Bitcoin. For instance, the major most liquid asset in the world, maybe Bitcoin now, but it's probably US dollars. And so a lot of payments between one currency and another currency actually go through US dollars, because that's the most liquid path that they have available, the cheapest path. In the Ripple system, BTC has more of a counterparty risk in the Ripple system, because you have to trust someone to hold your Bitcoin. It's like, if you have these BTC, you're trusting Bitstamp to hold your Bitcoin. And if you have these, you're trusting this company BTC to Ripple to hold your Bitcoin. You can always redeem those coins, but with XRP, you trust the network as a whole. And so it's, from our perspective, a much more trustworthy, valuable asset than these BTC IOUs. And so our goal is to make XRP the most liquid asset. Okay, yes?
So are you still using consensus protocol, or is there a blockchain?
Yes, so this system uses the consensus protocol, which effect creates the blockchain.
So what's the settlement time?
The settlement time, and I'll demonstrate this in a minute, is 5 to 7 seconds for complete settlement. So with and that's the reason they didn't want mining. With mining, you're looking at 10 minutes to 1 hour. Well, unless you want to take a risk and use like Block Cipher's risk tolerance API or whatever, you can do a few seconds. But with consensus, settlement takes 5 to 7 seconds, and then it's done. Yeah, there's definitely arbitrage taking place. There are only a few major issuers of Bitcoin right now. I think maybe half a dozen. But there are price differences, which is fascinating, I find. Some people prefer to hold Bitstamp dollars because they're more trustworthy. I mean, Bitstamp Bitcoin, they're more trustworthy, though some other ones might clear faster. So there's a different price arbitrage.
In terms of number of transactions that process per second, do you know what the number is?
Yeah, well, in our benchmarking, the best we've achieved is 500 transactions per second. Though on the live network, it's probably more like 200. We haven't tried to max out the live network transactions per second, but you could try.
I was just thinking, Visa just process 12,000 transactions per second. If they were to come in, the group can't handle it.
Right. Yeah, so the question is, Visa is processing 12,000 transactions per second. There's no way that a consensus system like this or like Bitcoin could possibly handle that. And that's not what we're going for at all. We're not going for retail type payments. We're going for global cross-border settlement and cross-currency trading, which is significantly lower volume as far as number of payments, often significantly higher in terms of total capitalization of those payments. Okay, so I want to take a break from me talking, and everyone, most people have Mac or PC. Is anyone using Linux here? Great, good. I have my Ripple wallet here, Ripple client. It's a downloadable wallet. There's analogs in the Bitcoin world, of course, download them. And I would like everyone to download this now if you can. And so if you go to anypay.io, this is a company that offers Ripple-based solutions, anypay.io. And if you notice at the top, they have this Ripple desktop wallet. And please download the wallet, and I will send you some XRP to get started. So the way it works, once you download the wallet, you will want to create a new account and then create an empty account. And this will create a public-private key for you. You will be able to download, it will save that public-private key encrypted on your hard drive. And then once you do that, I already saved one, so I'm going to go ahead and open it up. Once you get your wallet set up, your Ripple address will be here under the fund section. And if you grab that and then send it in an email to me, and I will fund your account. So my email is steven@ripple.com. There you go. Is there a Slack?
Yeah.
Oh, that would be great. What? Do you know what the Slack is?
Blockchain.
this inpay.io?
Yeah, so this wallet is a build of, if you want to see it in action on GitHub, github.com/ripple. This is where all of our open source software is. Our closed source software is here too, but you can't. No, I'm gonna log out. Okay. And so it should be here, Ripple Client Desktop. So this software is a build of this open source application. Okay. Does anyone have any questions about downloading the wallet? Oh, right. Yeah. Great. Those are the currencies that have been issued. And it's questionable whether in the future a lot of currencies will be issued into the ledger. Our goal really is to connect different ledgers, not necessarily have a database where people have like a central ledger where people put all of their currencies. But also Ripple Charts doesn't by default display all the currencies. We actually don't know all the things that people create because it's an open blockchain. Yeah.
What kind of adoption have you seen in banks? Mm-hmm.
We have several dozen banks that have built integrations into the system, with a lot more coming online in the next year. So a lot of banks. It's actually pretty exciting. Right, maybe a year ago, we didn't have a lot of banking customers, and we finally built some solutions for them specifically that help them utilize the Ripple blockchain while also keeping their transactions super private and giving them all of their auditing and compliance things that they need. So that took a while to develop, but we're there now.
So what's the incentive for somebody to run a Ripple node?
Okay, great question. What's the incentive for someone to run a Ripple node? Well, I'm going to start by showing you. This is something that I made with some other people on my team. This is our peers dashboard showing the number of peers in the network. So we have 110 peers in the network. Those are people running the Ripple D software. And they run a node in order to get access to transaction history, to submit transactions to the network. It has useful features. In order to get their own, like for instance, there's a feature called path finding, which gives you the cheapest path to pay between different currencies. That's CPU intensive. So if you run your own node, you get much better performance. Ripple hosts public nodes that you can use, but a lot of people are using those, so there might be bottlenecks. So there's a lot of incentive to run your own node.
Steven@ripple.com?
Yes, steven@ripple.com. Is it blockchainu@.slack.com? Jeff, did you say you were inviting me to this? Oh, great. Okay, somehow I need to create a password. Maybe not.
Thank you.
Ooh, okay. I'm in the Slack, looks like. Yeah, I would say send it in here. Yeah, if you send it into here to the general, that would be better than emailing me, probably. So that I can send one of you a bunch of XRP, and then you can help everyone else out by sending them some.
Just send your email.
Okay. Well, let's see. Where is my email? I am on the Slack now. Okay, so if you want the XRP, you need to send me your public key. So here's someone sent me their public key. That was you. Great. And in order to send funds, in order to have a Ripple account, you need a minimum of 20 XRP in your account. That is to prevent people from spamming the ledger and creating unlimited accounts. So 20 XRP right now is worth like a cent or something. I don't know. Maybe a few cents.
Do we create an empty account or create a new account with secret key?
Create an empty account. To create a new account with a secret key would be if you already had a secret key, which probably you don't. And, oh no. So to send to an account, the most basic thing you can do is send XRP. So right now it's submitting the transaction to the network, and it takes about 5 seconds to confirm. So here we can see the transaction was successful.
Yep.
And you received 100 XRP?
Yes.
Excellent. And we can view that. You know about blockchain, blockchain.info. It's a great public place to see transactions. We can view that also. Oh no. If you go to ripplecharts.com, I think Accounts Explorer will do it. All right. And then I'm gonna hit that transaction. So you can see the transaction that we just made from me to him. Sending 100 XRP. And you notice there's a 0.012 XRP fee. So this is kind of like a fee in Bitcoin, except there's no miners, so no one gets the fee. It's actually, the fee is destroyed. So every time there's a transaction on the network, the total number of XRP in existence goes down by 0.012.
Why is
that? That is to prevent spam and attacks on the network. To introduce an economic cost of transacting so that it's not flooded with transactions.
So how's Ripple created? It's always being destroyed.
Yeah. So how is the XRP created? All of the XRP, it is a centralized pre-mining scam. All the XRP was created at the beginning, January 1st of 2013, I believe, or 2012, whenever it was created. All of it went to, at the time, OpenCoin, the company. Then they set aside, they gave some to the founders of the company, and set aside most of it for development of the protocol. And so my salary is paid in XRP, 100% of it. And yeah, it's pretty cool. I like it. So that it goes to fund development. In the future, it will go to fund liquidity. to make markets highly liquid to the XRP asset in order to make it much easier for people to get liquidity to all the different assets in the world.
I'm sorry, I was doing something. Could you go over that feed again with the miners? Oh, I'm sorry, the feed, I didn't catch that. You said with every transaction there was a fee, I guess.
So the network requires a fee. Network fee paid 0.012 XRP. And that fee is destroyed. So essentially it goes to the holders of XRP as in form of depreciation. Yeah. No, sorry, deflation. In the form of deflation, so appreciation.
When you receive or send XRP, does it generate a new public address? Like in Bitcoin, your wallets, you have a new address every time?
No. So Ripple is not aiming for anonymity. Okay. So you reuse the same account every time. It is truly for known entities. Okay. No one knows that this is me until now.
Bitcoin, they also do it as a forward security thing. It's like, because once you spent from an address, the public key is visible, and it may be possible, one day to crack that, figure out private keys to public keys.
Oh, okay, so
it's like a quantum computer thing, right?
Right. So the question is...
Bitcoin does also have a security perspective, not just the anonymous perspective.
Don't want to expose public keys for potential quantum attacks in the future.
Yeah.
I think basically we are not attempting to mitigate against quantum computing.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah. And if that when that becomes an issue, we'll create a new system. I think this one will have
it's
to
not,
be scrapped.
Not a
concern. Yeah. I mean. All of the banks and all the financial institutions in the world would have to upgrade to quantum computers and quantum cryptography. So, that wasn't a concern.
Yeah, I mentioned it because they don't do it. It's not done entirely just for the obvious reasons. There's two reasons.
Does everyone have the wallet? Does anyone not have the wallet?
Yep. The Slack is full of addresses.
Okay, great. So can I send one of you a bunch of XRP and then you send it to everyone else?
Yes.
Would that help? Slack. Well, yeah, it's going to be easier on Slack because it's more public. Wasn't I just on this?
Send a bunch to me then.
No, here it is. Okay. So we're in general. We've got Jeff already has XRP.
Quarter.
Okay, who's T Matcha?
That's me.
Can I send you some and then you send to some of these other people?
Sure.
Okay. And then I want everyone to just practice sending. So I'll give you great. And there may be a bug, which I'm really embarrassed about. But I'll give you 2,000.
Rich. So what is the exchange rate anyway?
Exchange rate right now, it's about 0.45 cents per XRP.
So what is 2,000?
$9?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was $9. So you received the XRP.
I got it, it's very quick.
Yeah, who's Sue? I'll send you some also.
10,000.
So don't send them to him. 10,000. I'm gonna make it 5. Just 5 total. Man, there's an awful bug. Wow.
Yeah, it's not doing it for me.
It's not doing that bug for you.
Actually,
wouldn't it? Wow. My strategy is to paste twice, and then go back and delete the first half.
Whoever CJ Kula is, I think your address is pasted on. It's saying it's not a valid Ripple address.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay, I think you just got 500. What was your question?
Are there any websites?
There are web-based wallets. Yeah, great question. So in the beginning, we made at Ripple a wallet. It was ripple.com/client. Not sure if that. And then we transitioned that to be Ripple Trade. So Ripple Trade is a web-based wallet with a lot of disclaimers in Chinese. And in order to use Ripple Trade, you have to provide a bunch of KYC information because we were sued by the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network. So this is something that Ripple Labs is not happy about. Let's see, there's also gatehub.net.
Yeah, I think you pasted that right.
Every time I paste an address, it says it's not valid.
Yeah, paste it twice. Man, that's really embarrassing. I'm sure they've built a new upgrade if you want to build from source. Gatehub.net is a web-based wallet also. I know that Ripple Trade does browser encryption. It encrypts in the browser with your password, so they never hold your secret key. I believe GateHub is the same. This is a pretty cool wallet, if you want. And then there are other wallets that I don't recommend.
Okay, I'm going to try this, Chris. Yeah, it's still not saying it's valid.
Okay. Who else has received XRP?
I received like just it.
You three. Who's this?
Oh,
did I send that to you? Who's this? Okay, I'll send you some.
I don't get this.
Yeah, fortunately, I pay my rent in Bitcoin. And so there are services that allow you to transfer funds from the Ripple network to the Bitcoin ledger. And so that's our ultimate goal, is to be able to send funds from one ledger to another ledger. And so I send from my XRP account to my Bitcoin account.
And your landlord accepts Bitcoin.
Yes.
See, my landlord only accepts
Well, I guess there's those Bitcoin services that allow you to send them Bitcoins and then they send you a check.
Like Ripple the Bitcoin to like Coinbase and then writes a check or something.
I guess let me rephrase the question. So how do you, how frictionless is it to get to like being able to use a Visa or MasterCard to be able to interact with retail establishments?
That is not even really a use case for Ripple. I guess there used to be a card called Shift Payments that allowed you to fund the card directly with Ripple. And you could actually give it your Ripple secret key and they would just draw from your account. And then they were shut down for compliance reasons. So
Shift Payments was shut down?
Well, no, their Ripple integration was shut down. Now they're much more boring. They're Dwolla only.
Oh.
They're about to add Coinbase, they say. Okay, so.
Can you like see if I'm doing some wrong?
Can I what?
Can you see if I'm doing some wrong ones? Okay. I don't understand it. So.
Yeah, I think it's just this build is really broken. Yeah, so if you paste it two times.
And it's just an invalid address.
And then you go back and.
Oh, delete that out?
Yeah, wherever it starts, right here.
Oh, okay.
Oh. Oh. Man.
Okay.
Well, I'm quite embarrassed. He got a GateHub account up.
Thanks.
Oh, cool.
Let us.
Yeah, this anypay.io has a really old build.
So is this like a what's the equivalent? It's like a SPV wallet kind of thing. Like, I would say thing finding down the whole chain or ledger. How's Ripple different? Mm-hmm. I know in Bitcoin you need to download the whole blockchain or you have like
Great question. Is this well like an SPV client where it's a simplified payment verifier? The way this works is it connects to a trusted node. So if you go to your settings, I believe it's in advanced. Yeah, so you can specify your Ripple D server that you want to trust. And you give it the IP address or domain and port number, and you can connect to that Ripple D. So a lot of the time, I will have my own Ripple D running, and it keeps a copy of the whole ledger. You can put localhost there, yeah, or 127.0. The level is a few hundred gigabytes, I think. Actually, I don't know. You know, great part is you don't have to keep a copy of the entire ledger history. The ledger history is a very large database. But the way that the ledger tree is structured, it's a radix Merkle tree, if you want to get into that. And it allows you to keep the balances of all accounts in a much smaller format.
So like Bitcoin vocabulary would be like the unspent outputs of the block hashes only?
Yeah, a lot like the unspent outputs.
So it's like a pruning.
It's a tree where all the leaf nodes are the account balances and the account roots, and then all of the inner nodes are not needed.
Okay.
Yeah, and so that's the ledger. And so I'm going to explain in more detail the Ripple D ledger. Let's see. Okay, so we hopefully a good number of you have interacted with the wallet on a basic level. I want to now go into more detail about the consensus and the ledger itself. Okay, so the Ripple ledger is a distributed database that's run by all of the nodes in the network. We've seen there's about 110 different nodes. Maybe a third of those are Ripple themselves, and then the other two thirds are third parties that use it. Okay, so the ledger is run on all of the nodes that want to have it. They can store a copy of it. Transactions are added to the ledger through a process called consensus, which is essentially voting on which transactions are valid or not. Okay, so at the core of the network, there are validating nodes. These nodes, they gather in all of the transactions that people submit. So if you submit a transaction from your local wallet, it will go if we imagine that your local wallet is one of these hexagonal objects, and then you will submit it to a node, which is a peer in the network, and that peer will broadcast to all of its other peers the transaction, the signed transaction hex object. And it will eventually make its way to the set of validating nodes. And the validating nodes, they gather all the transactions every 5 to 7 seconds, and they vote on a set of transactions that they want to apply to the ledger. If your transaction is voted on by a supermajority, which is 80% of the validating nodes that you trust, then it will go into the ledger. And then once it's added to the ledger, a new ledger is created and broadcast to all the peers in the nodes, which are then pushed out to all the clients, like WebSocket clients, like your desktop wallet that you have. Questions about that basic peer communication?
As one who runs the validating nodes.
We'll get there in a second.
Will you talk later about sort of the benefits of that versus proof of work?
Oh, yeah. Okay, so who runs the validating nodes? I'll just talk about it. Anyone can run a validating node, and I highly recommend if you are building something with Ripple to run a validating node. It's the only difference is a slight config change from a normal peer to a validating node. Anyone can run those nodes, though in order to achieve a global consensus, there is a core set of nodes that the community as a whole trusts to validate their transactions. And that almost all of that is Ripple Inc. nodes at the moment that people trust. I'm on a team called a decentralization team. Our entire objective is to get highly trusted nodes from all of our different partners to be validating nodes. So it is much less inclusive than Bitcoin mining. With Bitcoin mining, anyone can throw hashing power at validation, and then the network trusts them, which incurs a tremendous cost. Tremendous cost as far as real resources, electricity in the network, and also a cost in terms of a lot of institutions don't want to trust anonymous people to validate their transactions. I am totally fine with trusting the miners to validate all of my transactions, but a lot of institutions don't want that.
It's a lot more corporate friendly now.
Yeah. They want to have knowable entities.
Okay.
So how do you become a validated node? Does Ripple have to say you're trusted, you're part of our group?
Well, ultimately, to become a validator node, you turn on the flag that says, I'm now broadcasting validations. And then you have to get other people to add you to their list of trusted validators. So each validating node has an explicit list of other trusted validators. In the future, that will probably be more dynamic, where it's composed mainly of, our goal is to have a list that is composed of different types of companies in different legal jurisdictions. Nodes that are on different internet backbones, so that if like one network backbone goes down, the whole network isn't compromised. So our goal is to have a very diverse set, and we will recommend to people to choose certain validating nodes. Though they can choose whichever validators they want on their list. Though that has led to some high-profile failures in Ripple-like systems, particularly Stellar. If you're familiar with the Stellar system, it's a fork of Ripple, and they were not careful enough with their validator list, and they ended up getting a fork of their ledger, where some payments happened on part of the network but didn't happen on another part of the network. So it is actually very important to have to be very explicit about the validator set that you trust. Long term, it will be companies from all different jurisdictions, different server providers that are running validators.
So what's the difference between like a regular validating node and a central validating node, you want to call it? Like supernodes or central validating node?
There's no difference. It's that there's a set of validating nodes that almost everyone puts on their trusted list. So those I call the core validators because they're the most trusted in the network. And that's what makes them special. It's not any physical difference. It's that people trust them to verify transactions.
So is their vote weighted more heavily?
Each person, so everyone can vote. As a validator, I vote on what I think should be the next ledger. Anyone can take my vote and accept it or discard it. Basically, if I'm not on their list of trusted validators, they won't pay attention to my vote at all.
And so how do they, when you apply to become a validated node, what information are you providing? How are you saying, like, this is my LinkedIn profile, this is like I work with these companies, or like this is my business, like what, how does that process work?
Well, our very first, let me show you validators.ripple.com for more information about this. I created this also. What this system does is it tracks the validations of all the nodes in the network as they broadcast them. It counts them up and it computes different statistics on them. The number one most important thing that we look for with validators is actual performance. We're very keen on making sure that everyone processes transactions neutrally without without preventing others from transacting. So no payment has ever been reversed in the history of the Ripple ledger, and we process all transactions neutrally that are submitted. So
if the payment were reversed, who would do that?
In Bitcoin, the miners would reverse a payment, okay. Right? So in Ripple, it's almost even more arbitrary. The validators themselves could decide to be on a totally different ledger and discard all transactions. And so we recently built a mechanism where you can enter your domain into your Ripple account, and it will verify that you own that domain via like a two-step verification process. It's automatic. And then we'll calculate information on a daily basis on how well your validator performs and publish that information. So first thing we look for is performance. In the future, we'll be gathering data about where you are, who you are, what your company is like, and publish all of that. And so we're really looking to publish information about validators to let people make their own decisions. We're also going to recommend trusting certain validators so that we have a cohesive network. There's no application process though. You can, RippleDividend.com. I don't even know who that is. So they didn't apply for anything. They just started their validator. And they've been running for a few months, so they're actually well qualified. I wouldn't mind adding them to my node list.
So essentially, there's 109 votes on each transaction, and there has to be, is it a simple majority degree or consensus?
It's actually configurable per node. This thing is way too configurable, but it's 80%. We've calculated in our white paper, and then in peer reviews of the white paper, that in order to achieve Byzantine fault tolerance, where someone might try to attack the network, we need 80% consensus to avoid a fork, and worst case, someone would be able to prevent transactions from happening. But 80% consensus is what we're shooting for. This page lists the validators that are validating right now or in the past day. Okay, so like I was saying, in order to inject false data, an attacker would need to compromise 80% of the validating nodes. And unlike with Bitcoin, if in Bitcoin you wanted to get 51% of the hashing power, you just need a bunch of machines. In this consensus system, you would have to compromise 80% of the organizations that are running validators. So it would be much more of a social engineering task to compromise the network. Okay, so Ledger 101. The ledger is a list of balances, accounts, and trade offers. So you all created an account, and if you received XRP, then your account is in the ledger. It has one balance, which is XRP, though it can hold an unlimited number of balances. And you can also place, You can also place orders to trade those assets. And these are all stored in the Ripple ledger. So if you're running the Ripple daemon, you get a copy of the Ripple ledger. Okay, so whenever new transactions come up, they are going to be validated or rejected within 5 to 7 seconds. So we have a sequence, an unending sequence of several dozen thousand ledgers that have been processing 24/7 for the last 3 years or so. If we look here in this diagram, N is the current ledger. It describes the current state of all accounts in the ledger. N minus one is a previous ledger that describes the state of all accounts in that ledger, which was about 10 seconds ago. N minus two was about 15 seconds ago, and that describes the state of all accounts. In order to validate a new ledger, you only need N, the current ledger. So with the Bitcoin blockchain, you need the entire history to sum up all the unspent outputs in order to determine if a transaction is valid. With the Ripple consensus ledger, you only need the snapshot of the current ledger, which is the current state. So it's, there's no unspent output type stuff. It's more of a traditional accounting system. So what happens is there's a ledger, people start submitting transactions, they become candidates to be accepted into the ledger, and then the validators will, or all the nodes will broadcast them around, and the validators will vote on them. Okay, so this is us transitioning from the current state of the ledger plus 6 transactions that they want to apply to the ledger, which yields us the next ledger, the next state of the ledger. Any questions about basically how transactions are applied in the ledger?
So it has all the history in N plus one. You don't need the N for the history?
Right, so the history is a history of all ledgers, and a ledger is a snapshot of accounts.
Like past transactions, I can tell all that with the current snapshot?
You don't, no. So the question is, can you tell past transactions from the current snapshot? No. You would need a history of the transactions, which your Ripple D can contain. Though it's not required, you don't need to know a history of past transactions. As long as you know the current state of the ledger, you can calculate whether new transactions are valid, can validly apply to the next ledger. So that's something I find very interesting. You don't actually have to know the history of the transactions. This is very different from the Bitcoin blockchain. Okay, so basic rules for applying a transaction. It has to meet the specification for a transaction, which is a JSON format serialized to hex. It has to have a sequence number, a monatomically increasing sequence number. And it has to, you have to have enough money. Say you're trying to send 5 ounces of gold and you only have 4 ounces, then it's going to be rejected. Also, if you are trying to send a payment but you don't have any XRP, you don't have that 0.012 XRP for a fee, it's going to be rejected. Okay, so someone decides to submit a transaction to the network. This is you with your wallet, or this is a bank that wants to clear funds to another bank across the world. They decide to create a transaction. They form the transaction JSON. They hash that and then create a signature of the hash. Should be relatively familiar with this kind of pattern with Bitcoin. Then they submit that signed transaction to the network, to one node that they're connected to. You just need one connection to the network. And that node will then relay the transaction to all the other nodes. Then each validator will say, I've received 100 transactions that are proposed, and I'm going to say, I propose these 100 to go into the ledger. I've seen 100, I think all of them are good. I'm proposing that they go into the ledger. and all validators will propose a set. So one validator might only have 95 for some reason. Maybe there's a network problem and they only receive 95 of those transactions. They will propose all 95. And then they will go through a step of agreement where they go back and forth and essentially negotiate which transaction sets are valid that everyone agrees on. And this is a cascading agreement, so they reduce the number of transactions until they have 80% agreement. And then they also continue to relay transactions. Once they had 80% agreement, everyone says, okay, 80% of my peers agree, I'm just gonna accept what they say. Basically is how it works. So if you're part of an outlier 20%, you yield to the rest of the network because you trust these nodes.
Is there kind of a canonical ordering of the block so that it's easy to come to an agreement about what that looks like? What the component transactions are? Everybody will come up with the same block?
I imagine, well, it's a set of transaction hashes that they're looking for. So what is the canonical ordering? I'm not sure if there's an ordering. It's really just a set of hashes. So I don't know the algorithm. Yes, there's an algorithm implemented to order them, but I don't know what it is. I recommend github.com/ripple/rippled. It is a giant piece of code. Okay, so once they all agree, they execute the transactions, they put them into the ledger, they say this is the new ledger, and then they gather all the votes again. Once they have the final ledger that they want, they validate it again and then gain the votes. Once they have a supermajority, it says confirmed, and that's broadcast out to all the peers in the network. Okay.
What's to prevent like a 51% attack?
Can you repeat the question?
What is to prevent a 51% attack? Well, in order to stop consensus, you need to gain control over 20%+ of the trusted nodes in the network. If you can gain control over 20%+, you can prevent consensus from achieving its quorum of 80%. In order to insert false transactions into the ledger, you need to gain control of 80% of the trusted nodes in the network. So in our case, 50% is not, it is completely irrelevant. Consensus is not determined by hardware power. We could all run a Ripple network ourselves here, and our laptops could be the ones validating, and we would have to compromise 80% of the people in this room in order to add false transactions into the ledger. So the thing is, like, if we all agreed that we'll count one node per person on our trusted list, then if you add 50 nodes, we're still only going to count you one time. We're not gonna add all 50 of your nodes to the list. So the validators in the Ripple network are intended to be known entities. It's not an anonymous thing. So you can't throw hardware power at it, and one organization can't run a bunch of nodes and gain control, because we'll only really trust that organization for one node.
Sorry, maybe you covered that in the other question.
I probably covered it insufficiently, so thank you for the question.
Just on that same subject, if sort of before somebody would attempt such an attack, I would think maybe you'd be able to read signals about, like, there seems to be a group that's intending to do something different here. I mean, it seems like you'd be able to gather intelligence about that and maybe shut off that part of the network. I mean, nodes could be untrusted, and then you might get a fork of some kind. Is that kind of scenario we looked at?
Yeah, so the question is, like, what type of fork detection capabilities do we have? And with our validator registry system, this is an open source software anyone can run and gather all the data about validators in real time. But we calculate things like agreement and disagreement, see how often do they agree. So some of these nodes, they agree less probably because they have bad network connections or something. They don't get all the transactions. But if we start seeing people disagreeing a lot, they wouldn't be re-added to the list of trusted nodes.
They could get eliminated from trusted.
Right, right. In the future, the trust will be more determined automatically based on performance. And if you're deviating, then you probably will be ejected, because there's no real reason to deviate. Everything's cryptographically provable, all the transactions. So theoretically, everyone should just accept every signed transaction indiscriminately. OK, any questions about the consensus system?
So could you become a trusted node and then set up other nodes and say, I trust this node, and then I trust that node, but in reality, it looks like there's a whole lot of trust going on, but it's just one node that then, as they become trusted, then starts to build up a network of other trusted nodes that they control?
So could you establish several trusted nodes and have them trust each other and create a network? And then you could do that. You still have to convince others to trust you. And that's probably a difficult task. But if you did, and then you got a certain portion of the network to trust your nodes, and then you started deviating, you could create a fork. The key is that most people are more aware of the trustable entities. And often they ask Ripple Labs to provide a trustworthy set that we've deemed are trustworthy. But our goal truly is, we don't want to run the consensus network. It is not in our best interest at all to be some type of central operator. And so we're constantly promoting with our partners that they become more trustworthy and that we can accept them into our sphere of trust, essentially. There's maybe a cool movie here.
Ripple is a system for making transactions on the internet.
I probably explained all this.
We can pull this mic to sound,
I think I explained all this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to show some more fun things. So I want to show a demo of some cross-currency payments that you can use in Ripple. I know I talked about at the very beginning, our goal is to have cross-ledger payments. And so in the Ripple consensus system, the way we've implemented is that it stores tons of different ledgers in the database. If we were looking at charts, each of these different assets is a ledger where people hold balances. And one of my favorite ledgers is the SF Gold Vault ledger, which they store gold in a vault, and then you can get gold asset in your Ripple wallet. And I'll show you how that works. It's on here. And I don't have, luckily we don't make USB ports anymore, so I can't plug into the screen. I didn't bring the adapter. That's kind of embarrassing. Does anyone have one of these things? Is it USB-C?
No.
Then No, it won't work.
Do you know yourself the wallets that you say the file?
I guess I could email myself the file.
Airdrop.
All right. I'll just open up my entire machine for anyone to access my files on the Wi-Fi, and then. Okay, welcome back. I wanted to demonstrate some more of the cross-currency functionality. Gave you the very basics of XRP. Most people in the Ripple world aren't really interested in XRP per se. I find great interest in it because I'm into alternative currencies, but most people want to use existing ledgers. They want to connect existing ledgers. And so looking in my wallet now, wow, 7,000. Oh, okay. funny story, but I have a handful of different assets in this wallet. I have Bitcoin, gold at the SF Gold Vault up in the city, and a friend of mine, Hike, created his own currency called Hike Coin. I sent it back, though. I don't have any. And then these US dollars, they're issued by a company called SnapSwap, which is, I believe, based out of Canada. And I can send any of these assets, and I can have them convert into other assets. And the reason they can be converted is because there are orders on the Ripple exchange to convert, to buy and sell these assets for each other. I think most of them are mainly making markets from the asset to XRP. There's a feature in Ripple that we call auto bridging, which it takes the order books for one asset to XRP and another asset to XRP, and makes it more transparent, so it looks like there are orders directly for each other. You don't even see the XRP in between. But it's a really great way to manage your liquidity if all you have to have is XRP to make all kinds of markets. And I want to show you a demonstration of SnapSwap. So this is a lot like Coinbase. This is a ledger that's it's not the Ripple ledger. It's a ledger where you can get dollars on it. It's like Coinbase or Bitstamp. You can do bank transfers or you can send to Ripple. And one key feature that we're going for with our interledger protocol and what we're calling Internet of Value is the ability to send payments to things like this identifier you see on the screen, Steven Zeiler at snapswap.us. So our goal is to be able to send money, not to one of these hashes, like cryptographic hashes, but to an email address style thing. and so I can probably send dollars to this account. So I go to my Ripple client and I'll enter that in. So instead of the address, I enter Steven Zeiler at snapswap.us, and that actually looks up, it uses the DNS system and IP system to query SnapSwap for this Steven Zeiler name. And that returns back to my client the appropriate Ripple address and this tag that's specific to me. It's called a destination tag. So this is essentially routing information that helps us route the payment to the correct account on this third-party ledger. Any questions about that? The tag, the destination tag, is an entry in the transaction. It's part of the Ripple protocol. And it helps us specify, so this Ripple address you see, RMWJ, that's SnapSwap's address, and then each user at SnapSwap gets a tag.
SnapSwap's, they're all like their own separate.
SnapSwap is their own ledger. It's a SQL database.
Okay.
and it's hosted on this website, snapswap.us.
So your dollars on Ripple, they aren't secured by the Ripple system, they're being held by SnapSwap, your dollars.
Right, yeah. So if I have SnapSwap dollars, there are other dollars. There's Bitstamp dollars, there's Steven Zeiler dollars.
You have to pick a dollar holder that you trust.
If you want to hold dollars, so you asked, you have to pick a dollar holder issuer that you trust. Okay. If you want to hold dollars, you need to trust that issuer. Like if you want to keep your money in a bank, you have to trust that bank.
Right. Okay.
Or the government. You know, trust the government. I wouldn't do that. So though I don't need dollars in my wallet to send dollars to this SnapSwap account. Okay? And the reason I don't need that is because the Ripple exchange provides cross-currency payments. So say I wanted to send $10. Let's enter in US dollar here. Ripple, the Ripple D software, performs a function that we call pathfinding. And what it does is it looks at all of the order books on the Ripple exchange, and it calculates all the possible assets that I have in my wallet that I can spend that will convert to dollars at the SnapSwap ledger. Okay, so it's done that, it's looked at the order books, it's determined that I can send $10 because I have dollars in my wallet. I could also send 2136 XRP. So there's a market from XRP to SnapSwap dollars. So I can spend XRP, the recipient will receive dollars. Also I have BTC, and there's a market there. And I have XAU, which is gold at the SF Gold Vault. And all of these assets have a market. I assume a market to XRP, but they could be a more indirect market, and the path would be taking multiple hops. Questions about paths, pathfinding? Does that make sense at all? Okay, so since gold's my favorite asset, I'm going to go ahead and send I'm going to send $10, they're going to receive $10, but I'm going to be spending 0.00959 ounces of gold. And it will convert instantly, and they'll receive dollars at the other end. So it's a basic Ripple transactions like we've seen before. Looks like the transaction's successful. It is now, here we go. So here's our transaction. We can look at that, ripplecharts.com. Go over to our account explorer and put in our transaction hash. All right, that was pretty straightforward. Oh wait, that's the wrong transaction hash. Am I crazy? I'm crazy, right? Okay, here we go. Here's the real transaction. All right, so this one's much more complicated than the one that you just saw. That was fun. Want to animate it again? Okay. So.
Those are the validation nodes?
So this node, this is me. This is where the transaction begins. And I believe this is the end node, SnapSwap. Yeah, RMW, that's SnapSwap's account. And these other nodes, these are market makers. So these nodes have placed orders to buy gold and sell dollars. Or buy gold, sell XRP. In this case, it's San Francisco SF Gold Vault gold. So there's one market maker I know for sure. There's one market maker that's made a market, put orders buying gold, selling XRP. Mm-hmm. And then there's another handful of market makers, I assume these guys, they are buying XRP and selling dollars.
So if I wanted to send you gold, I could only do it if you had an account with the SF Gold. reserve thing?
Correct. You can only send me assets that I have established an account with.
So if I send you gold and you didn't, it would just convert to something else you had?
The pathfinding algorithm would return no paths.
Oh, okay.
So if I have not established a connection to the gold vault.
So the KYC is handled when you sign up with the gold vault company?
They're,
in theory? Yes.
So in order to sign up with the Gold Vault company, you go over to your fund tab, mm-hmm. you click gateways. Here's where you establish your connections to the gateways. It actually requires no sign up at all for most of these assets that you see. All you do is connect gateway and you put the gateway's account, the Ripple address, and then the asset that you want to have them hold on your behalf.
But,
okay. Though, you asked about KYC. A lot of companies don't want you to have their assets unless you're a known entity. And so there's actually a feature in the Ripple ledger. When you create a new asset, when you create a new account, you can optionally say, all holders of my assets have to be pre-authorized. In which case, you would probably have to provide some type of KYC information to them out of band.
Right.
Then they would issue a transaction on the Ripple ledger authorizing your account.
So have you tried adding here before you did that in Switzerland?
No. Actually, all of these assets that we're looking at do not require pre-authorization.
Right, if they did require pre-authorization, you tried to add here, it just wouldn't work.
It just wouldn't work, yeah. If you tried to add it without being pre-authorized, if they require that.
It's interesting that they don't, because a lot of people got in trouble, like e-gold, et cetera, for KYC reasons. That's really interesting about the legal sticking point.
Yes, it is an interesting legal sticking point. And the reason it's there's options are because there are different jurisdictions with different requirements.
I got you.
Some places are free.
Mm-hmm. So that's the company to make sure they're being legally compliant.
Correct.
If they don't do a good job at that.
It's up to the company to make sure they're legally compliant. The Ripple system here is just a database.
Okay. I suppose it's kind of also up to the user to make sure, because if you sign up with someone who's not compliant and they go under, you lose your assets, right?
Right. Yeah. So if there's a non-compliant gateway, it essentially means that their customers they have no legal protection,
right?
So in order to gain legal protection, you have to comply with rules. There's a lot of instances where customers very explicitly agree. They say, we know this is not a regulated entity. We know they have not complied. We're still willing to hold their assets, and a lot of juries have ruled in favor of that. Sometimes. Okay, so we saw a cross-currency payment. Let's see if that showed up in my snap swap. There you go. We got $10 in my snap swap account just recently. That was the payment. So I sent gold and turned it to dollars.
I'm not sure if I'm at the right place.
SnapSwap
says it's continued its Ripple Gateway service for U.S. customers.
Yeah, so this is sad. SnapSwap is closing down in 1 week. So they have a service for European customers who can continue to use a service, snapswap.eu. Unfortunately, the U.S. Regulatory regime is not the best for them. I recommend not dealing with dollars.
The user account you have, really nice, Zeiler, SnapSwap. Is that something that's like available to just issuers, or?
So this is a protocol that we've established, and that we're working on formalizing a lot of these protocols. The way it works, though, we have. In order to communicate how, like, which protocols and which Ripple features you support at your company, we have this concept of a ripple.txt file. So you see /ripple.txt. This is kind of a convention. It's a little bit raw, but a lot of companies have ripple.txt files, and it specifies which types of currencies that they accept. SnapSwap does validation, so this is their validator key.
if I had my own website and domain name, I could put a ripple.txt file in?
Yes.
Give myself a simple address?
So the way it works here, ripple.txt, we have this protocol called Federation Protocol, and this is a HTTP JSON protocol that your domain can speak, where someone will give it a name to look up, and it will return whether it can make a payment, which type of currencies are supported, and what the address and destination information is.
I'm curious, is that something that you can do yourself?
Anyone can do it. It's an open protocol.
Right.
Yeah.
So you can create your own addresses to accept instead of handing out the long cryptographic hash.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So SnapSwap for EU, is that going to be just for euros or anybody living in the
EU? Is SnapSwap EU for just euros or anyone? I don't know. Probably just euros. Probably just euros. Maybe Bitcoin.
Is it why Snapchat is shutting down? Is it KYC issue?
SnapSwap is shutting down because of they can't get licenses in the United States. Yeah.
Interesting enough for the bug I was having when I typed in your SnapSwap address, that works. Or is it? It might work, it resolves, it doesn't freak out. When I type in the whole address though, it doesn't work.
Yeah, yeah, the bug does, fortunately does work with these federated names.
Yeah.
So if you look at here, there's like this JSON API for the SnapSwap or the Federation protocol. And it requires several different parameters. But once you do that, it needs to be a Bitcoin address. Interesting. Well, I don't know. This is documented somewhere. We're developing much more robust, better protocols. But our whole concept is that we want identity to be distributed domain-based identity. And we even want ledgers to be domain-based ledgers and payments to be all domain-based so that you don't have to use a particular ledger. You can just give someone like email address type thing. And that will work. So I'm going to show a few things that some people have built with Ripple. This one is it's a lot like Stripe, or maybe even Coinbase, but for our cross-currency payments with Ripple. So the idea is that you would say, like, I want to receive some amount in some currency, and then whoever needs to pay that can pay with whatever currency that they have, and it will convert to the one that you want to receive. So let's say I wanted to receive some gold, XAU, 1/1000th of an ounce of XAU, which is gold, and I want, what's my Ripple address? Here's my Ripple address. So I'll put my Ripple address. And it should create some type of invoice thing to pay. You've probably seen something similar to this with BitPay or Coinbase or Stripe even. And it says, pay to the order of this address, this much gold, and with this destination tag. So if we look in our wallet here, I can send to that address, I'll get my destination tag, which is very important, and the amount of gold that I want to send. And it performs pathfind. It says I can send XAU or XRP. So in the spirit of cross-currency payments, I'll send XRP. And with any luck, there will be a real-time message sent out that it realizes it's been paid, and it will mark that invoice as paid. Oh. Well, it, yeah, there we go. Invoice paid. So you can build, you can start to build real-time cross-currency applications. This is just a simple application that was built. This is all within the Ripple Ripple database. So you're going from XRP ledger to a gold ledger, but it's all in the Ripple system. This one actually is cross ledger, so it allows you to convert assets from the Ripple ledger into assets on the Bitcoin ledger. And so it's fairly simple. You give it a Bitcoin address as your destination and the amount of Bitcoins you want to send, and it will give you an invoice to pay with a Ripple. And if you do that, it should send Bitcoins to your account with luck. So I'm going to get a Bitcoin wallet here. So this is my Bitcoin address, and I want to receive some amount of Bitcoin. So it's saying I will receive 0.01 BTC at that Bitcoin address if I pay this much on Ripple. And so either I need an asset on the Ripple ledger or another ledger that is compatible with Ripple. And ultimately, we want to be able to chain multiple ledgers so you can have payments going through all different types of ledgers. So we're only looking at two different ledgers now. But if I try this, with any luck, it will actually send Bitcoins. Okay, so it's calculated paths, and it says I can send US dollars or XRP. So I've got my US dollars in my Ripple wallet in the Ripple ledger. I want to convert that to Bitcoin on the Bitcoin ledger. So I'm going to give it a shot, see if this service works. This is an example of a service that you could build that basically you're a connector connecting multiple ledgers. Boom, and there you go. So we send a payment from one ledger to another ledger, from the Ripple ledger to Bitcoin. And that was a simple connector. In the future, you'll be able to send from, say, a bank account ledger through the Ripple ledger to a Bitcoin ledger. Or
use the CoinGate gateway to do that?
Right, or, yeah, yeah.
So you sent XRP to CoinGate, and then they sent Bitcoin to your Bitcoin address.
So the way that this just worked was that I sent BTC to CoinGate on Ripple.
Like Ripple BTC.
Right, yeah, so it was Ripple BTC. CoinGate accepts one type of BTC, which is issued by them. And then they then forwarded that payment onto the Bitcoin ledger.
So what about like the other way? Like you have Bitcoin and you want XRP. They do that as well?
They don't do that yet. They want to.
What's like the easiest way to get XRP right now?
The easiest way to get XRP, I think, would be Bitstamp. Bitstamp allows you to send to Ripple. Additionally, any like Kraken or different altcoin exchanges will allow you to buy XRP.
Like an exchange, but not gateways, though. Like it doesn't automatically do this thing. You just do CoinGate, is it the exchange we buy?
That's more like an exchange.
Okay.
This isn't an exchange because the exchange component here is the Ripple exchange. So my XRP, or no, it was my USD. My 7 USD was converted on the Ripple exchange to BTC. And then ended up here at CoinGate.
Because that was cool when it just sent it and then turned it into Bitcoin automatically. It'd be cool if you could do that for Bitcoin to XRP.
Bitcoin
to
XRP, yeah. That is possible to do. You could build a thing where you could send from Bitcoin to Ripple. I would caution, though, to make sure and confirm a block.
If there was something out there that could do Bitcoin into XRP and turn it into like USD on XRP. Then you could like park Bitcoin into USD value.
Yeah. So what you're saying is interesting. That would be the Ripple exchange. If you wanted to send from Bitcoin to dollars on the Ripple network,
right.
It would send from Bitcoin to a Ripple gateway that does Bitcoin, and then it would exchange on the Ripple exchange for dollars.
So it all can, there's no gateway offer right now that does that.
Yeah, btc2ripple.com will do that for you.
Nice URL.
Maybe they're, they're probably running on Heroku or something where it takes a second to boot up a dyno.
The gateways, they don't seem to have issue or risk, really, because it's happened so quick. There's not much counterparty risk, because it turned it, the CoinGate, for instance, they turned it right to Bitcoin right away, and then you had Bitcoin. So you don't really have to trust CoinGate necessarily.
Yeah, you don't have to trust CoinGate, except they could just not pay you your bitcoins. But it's so fast.
When you have the bitcoin, you're good. The counterparty risk is just during that moment. Because the issuers, like the Snap one, you're holding their version of the dollars, and they can go down at any time. So you're not really parking it safely, I guess. But the gateway, I'm just trying to confirm the gateway, it sends it to you bitcoin right away, and then they've done their hands off after that, right?
Right. So with the Snap swap, they issued dollars and euros, and if you hold those, you're trusting Snap swap. It's the same as parking your money in a bank.
Sure, sure. But then with a gateway, though, they're hands off after they convert it. Whereas an issuer, they're still involved. You have an account with them, they hold your money.
Right. Yeah. This CoinGate gateway. It's not intended for people to hold assets there. It's
right.
It's mainly for connecting the two ledgers.
Okay.
So that's what we'll see more in Ripple in the future, is people hold money on the ledger that they trust the most, and they'll be able to convert it to another ledger using the Ripple protocols.
Okay.
Can you talk about escrow at all in the atomic structure of transactions?
Oh, yeah. So we're talking, question is about interledger. And
well, how does this escrow process work? You're going between three different things, and one middle. And so, we need to know that both of these things are being completed, and how the nodes validate that and confirm that this is a complete transaction.
In the Ripple ledger itself, the consensus ledger, if you have like multiple currencies that you're converting, say you have like. You want to send from yuan to pesos, and that goes like yuan to dollars to XRP to pesos. The Ripple database executes those trades atomically, so there is no need for escrow, because either the entire chain occurs or it doesn't. In the interledger world, which would be more than just the Ripple consensus ledger, it would be anyone's ledger, like more IP based, there's an escrow requirement where, say, you had those four hops. Each of the ledgers would have to sign a statement, a cryptographic signature, saying we have escrowed these funds, and they are being held until the person makes the initial payment, and then we'll disperse the funds.
So, does that system exist, or is that still being
that system? There is a. Implementation, an example implementation, github.com/interledger. It's either coming out this weekend or Monday. But it's a protocol intended to be implemented.
You had showed an example of a friend's currency, and you said you also have a Zelda mark or whatever. How do you add a currency like that as a gateway?
How do you add a new currency as a gateway? In order to add a new currency, you have to have someone establish a connection to your account and trust you to hold that currency. So in this case, let's see, I want to, here I've got some of my addresses here. I want to create a new currency called, I don't know, XXX. So I will go to the gateways section, and I want to receive XXX, the currency, from another account. So I need to connect to that gateway account. So this is their account, R4EW. And the currency I want them to hold on my behalf is XXX. So this currency doesn't exist yet, but I can I can enable them to issue currency into my wallet. Now that I'm connected with XXX, I can, this person here, this gateway, R4EW, they can issue unlimited numbers of XXX into my account. And my account balance, say they issued 100 XXX, my account balance would go up by 100. The gateway's account balance would go down by 100. So it's a double entry system where all assets are created out of nothing. So I learned from the real financial system. Take it back, Bitcoin's the real financial system. The fiat system. So just to, I'm gonna open up this R4EW account and show you that I can just create a new asset. Oh, you know what? I need to get this guy's address over here somehow. While I'm doing this, are there more questions? Oh, someone asked about when would someone create their own blockchain? Like, when would they take the Ripple software and instead of connecting to the Ripple network and the Ripple ledger, they just spin up their own and create their own network? And they might do that if they want to have a private ledger that's not publicly accessible, or a ledger that only certain people can connect to. And that has been done before. There are lots of forks. Almost all of them have failed. There have been forks of Ripple where someone took the software and created an entirely new network. And an entirely new ledger. But the way we see it, there's a lot of network effects. I mean, having one asset that's super liquid is necessarily requires a network effect. So you lose a lot of that by creating your own ledger. Though then again, you might want to not trust the Ripple validators and the validators in the Ripple consensus network to validate your transactions. So you might create your own ledger. Our goal really is to connect all of these ledgers with the interledger protocol. So it's okay if you fork your own, though. You probably won't be very successful in creating a new currency because of the network effects. I mean, who knows if XRP will ever be successful. Bitcoin certainly is.
Did you say Stellar?
Stellar, yeah. So Stellar was created by the co-founder of Ripple, who left the company early on and forked the code, released it. There were still all these references to XRP and Ripple and things in the source code. Kind of funny. And they created their own system. So that's stellar.org. They're a great, I like them. I think that's all about time that I have, all the time I have.
How do you log back in from the I logged out, I'm not able to get back in. Can you do that?
If you log out, how do you get back in?
Yeah, it's something really simple.
You do the select account file?
Yeah, but I can't see the file.
You don't know where you saved the file?
I do, it's in the hard drive.
Where? I mean, there's a file name, you gotta just find it wherever you saved it.
Yeah, I searched for it, I couldn't find it.
I don't know. It's on your hard drive somewhere, you say.
I'm not getting any results from the file name that I have in my wallet.
Wallet.
Do you know the file type?
No, I don't know the file type. I think it's a text file.
Yeah.
Text, maybe. It's not a. It doesn't have a file extension.
I just put it into the folder that I had when I downloaded the app, the same folder. And it's just a text file called wallet. It's in your wallet. I mean, if it might be in your temporary, if you didn't unzip the folder, but you just ran it, it might have created a temporary folder.
So very last thing, I'll only take like three more minutes of, I'm gonna show you how to send this XXX currency. So I'm pretty sure I can just send like 1,000 XXX to this guy here. So I'll create this out of nothing. Poof, there you go. We got 1111 XXX. And there's no way for anyone to get this or spend it because there's no liquidity. So you might want to create some orders on the order book for this currency. So I've got a trade section. These are all APIs in the Ripple D software. You can get the Ripple D software, run the daemon, and submit transactions.
The coin that represents your hours, you essentially offer to buy your coin back on the market.
Yeah, if coin represents my hours, I offer. You send me one Zeiler mark, I'll give you 1 hour of my time.
Rather than like you give it value, but like you go onto the exchange and you say like $60 with XRP or whatever, I'll buy a Zeiler mark.
Oh, I tell people put orders on the books for Zeiler mark. And if it's enough for me to take it, I'll take it. And then you've bought my time. So it's like place an order on an exchange. So if you ever use an exchange, I'm going to demonstrate it right here. If you've ever used an exchange, you place orders to buy or sell a certain asset for another asset. So in this case, I want to place orders for this XXX asset. So I'm going to go here. My base currency, I'm going to say it's XRP. My counter currency is going to be XXX, issued by this guy.
So
I can offer to buy XRP with my XXX, or I can offer to sell XRP for XXX. So since I have XXX, I want to offer to buy XRP for it. So I'll offer to buy 2222 XRP for the price of 2 XXX each. Oh, sorry, 1.5 XXX each.
So you essentially just created a price for XXX.
I've just set the price of XXX. It's equal to 0.5 XRP. And so now, if I wanted to send my X, someone could get my XXX by buying it on the exchange if they placed an order to sell XRP to X for XXX. Exchange. I would get XRP, you would get XXX.
Right. So is that what you do for the Zeiler mark? You sell them for XRP?
For Zeiler mark, I issue them and then other people place orders to buy them.
And you get XRP when they buy them?
Whatever they're offering to buy them for,
I
either accept or reject that order. And if I accept it, then they've bought my time.
Yeah. Cool.
Okay, well, that's my presentation on Ripple. Thank you for joining.